Today I'll be discussing the special issues which are there for neonatal transfusion. I'm Dr. Preeti Ellens from Department of Transfusion Medicine, Sanjay Gandhi PGI, Lucknow. There are a lot of special issues for neonates and small children which have to be kept in mind when we are providing blood to these small patients. These are the one of the most heavily transfused group in the hospital. And likelihood of transfusion is inversely related to gestational age and the birth weight. Lesser is the gestational age, greater is the likelihood that the neonate or a child will be transfused. The anemia is there because of the physiological decline in the hemoglobin at 2 months of age, and it is further aggravated by iatrogenic blood losses. The blood that we take out for investigations from a neonate or small children amounts to a greater percentage of its blood volume. And many a times this is the cause of the anemia in these patients. Also, the indications for transfusion are controversial, and many a times the transfusions are asked for in an arbitrary manner. So it's very important that we go into detail for these patients, because transfusion are not risk-free. So each transfusion should be evidence-based. As we can see in this slide over here, in a small neonate, the volume may be as small as 320 ml. Taking into account that only around 100 ml, 80 to 100 ml of the body weight will be the blood volume. So in a 3 kg neonate, it will be just 300 ml of the total volume. So when we see the phlebotomy loss during the first 24 hours in the ICU, this amounts to 3 to 10 ml. And this amounts to 0.9 to 25% of the volume of a small neonate. And weekly losses amount to as high as 6 to 50% of the blood volume. In contrast, when it is an adult patient, when the samples are withdrawn, the amount of blood loss is very small, a fraction of the blood volume. So in a small neonate, it assumes a greater proportion when we are drawing blood samples. The indications for transfusion for these patients could be either top-up transfusion, that means the hemoglobin is low and the patient is being transfused to increase the hemoglobin, or the reasons could be exchange transfusions for a number of reasons, which includes hyperbilirubinemia to remove the bilirubin, higher bilirubin level. Then there could be complex surgeries which these neonates or small children undergo, or extracorporeal membrane oxygenation. Why do we treat neonates as a special group? As we can see, there are significant physiological, hematological, metabolic, immunological, and differences are there from the adults, and these differences mandate different transfusion triggers, quantities of blood products, and care, with extrapolation of findings in the adult population. And these may necessitate different and sometimes unique approaches to the blood product preparation and the delivery. We might have to take special precautions for preparation of blood. We also know that they are the cardiac muscles or the myocardium, physiological differences are there. They are not as mature as the adult. Then there are hematological differences. They'll be having high level of fetal hemoglobin, which interacts poorly with 2-3 DPG. They have a decreased level of erythropoietin, reduced red cell half-life, and significant differences in the coagulation factors as compared to the adults. Then there are metabolic differences. It's difficult for them to metabolize citrate, which is there in the anticoagulated blood. So ionized hypocalcemia is more pronounced in neonates. Then dependency on calcium for the contraction and relaxation is there of the myocardium. So they respond in a much worse way to the hypocalcemia, which is triggered by blood transfusion. Then hyperkalemia, which is result of transfusion of stored red cell component, which is not very significantly clinically important for the adults, may be important, clinically important for the neonate. So we have to make special arrangements to prevent hyperkalemia for these patients. Then there are, we also know that there are immunological differences. They are immature, tolerant immune system is there until approximately 4 months of age. There are no ABO antibodies in the neonates. Also, they may not recognize foreign T cells to mount an immune response. They do not remove. So they are also target to the graft versus host disease, which is mounted by the lymphocytes in the foreign blood. However, there are immunoglobulins from the mother which are there, like IgG kind of anti-A, anti-B or Rh antigen can cross placenta, and passive immunity of this kind, passive antibodies could be there in the neonatal blood. And when we are doing compatibility testing, we have to keep a regard for these antibodies. Another important problem in the neonates is hypothermia. The neonates are predisposed to hypothermia because of the large surface area to weight ratio and shift of heat distribution from core to periphery with general anesthesia. If the patient is undergoing any operation, the cold operating room, irrigation solutions, they aggravate to these conditions. There could be also evaporative losses of heat, and to this, the large volume of cold blood, if it is transfused, adds to the hypothermia, and this leads to shift to left of the oxygen dissociation curve with a greater affinity of oxygen to the hemoglobin and less availability of oxygen to the tissues. On the contrary, there is increased oxygen consumption from the thermogenesis. So there is an imbalance of availability of oxygen and the utilization, and this exacerbates the coagulopathy in these patients. So we have to avoid hypothermia in these patients. Now we'll be talking about the issues in the neonatal transfusion. We know from our basic understanding of blood processing that any whole blood donation which is there can be processed into different blood component, and a maximum of 3 to 4 components can be prepared. Like we can prepare a unit of red cell, then a fresh frozen plasma, then a concentrate of platelets, or either cryopure plasma and a cryoprecipitate could be prepared. And the idea is that with the component preparation, we can benefit the patient in a much better way. We can give an appropriate dose of a required component to the patient. And also all these components have different preservation requirement. Like we can preserve the red cell for 42 days and it has to be preserved at 4 degrees centigrade. In contrast, the plasma has to be preserved at minus 20 to minus 30 degrees centigrade in the frozen condition. Platelets have to be preserved at 22 degrees centigrade, and the shelf life is only 5 days. The cryoprecipitate is again has to be preserved in the freezer, and it can be preserved for a year. The source of this component is either replacement or voluntary donors. These components are grouped for ABO, RHD, and also screened for antibodies. And it is mandatory to screen, in India it is mandatory to screen for anti-HIV 1 and 2, anti-hepatitis C, then hepatitis B surface antigen by ELISA, also test for syphilis by RPR, and for malaria is mandatory. This testing is country specific. Many of the countries also require screening for the endemic disease which are there. In their country, particular country. This is a unit of red cell. This is a additive solution, red cells preserved in the additive solution SAGM, which stands for saline, adenine, glucose and mannitol. And the volume of this red cell is around 350 ml, because to a packed red cell around 100 ml of additive solution has been added, and the hematocrit is around 60%. In an adult patient, if you transfuse 1 unit of red cell, it increases the hemoglobin percentage by 1 gram per deciliter. It also has, one has to keep in mind, around 200 milligram of iron. So as you go on increasing, the number of transfusion goes on increasing for a patient, the iron will keep on accumulating unless you take treatment for that. According to shelf life definition, around 80% of the red cells should survive for 24 hours when you transfuse these red cells. This unit of fresh frozen plasma is separated and frozen from the blood within 8 hours of collection, and it is around 200 ml and it contains all clotting proteins with a factor level of 1 unit per ml. So factor 1 to 13 are all present in a concentration of 1 international unit per ml. So basically it is indicated for conditions where there are multiple factor deficiency, maybe due to warfarin use, or maybe due to other reasons like coagulopathy, liver failure and DIC. This unit of platelets prepared from the unit of whole blood is called as random donor platelet, and there are 4 into 10 to the power 10 platelets per unit of random donor platelet. In an adult, at least 6 to 8 units have to be transfused to give one dose. In contrast, in a neonate or a small child, 1 or 2 unit may be adequate. The cryoprecipitate volume is 10 to 20 ml, and there is factor 8, around 80 international unit per unit of cryo. There is also von Willebrand factor which is there, and fibrinogen which is there. So cryo can basically is used in countries where the factor 8 is not available for treatment for hemophilia A patients. For hemophilia B patients, cryo cannot be used because there is no factor 9. Instead, cryo poor plasma, which is a byproduct of preparation of cryoprecipitate, has to be used. Now, the triggers for RBC transfusion in a neonate are, if there is a severe cardiopulmonary disease, then hemoglobin level of 13 gram per deciliter, less than 13 gram per deciliter, is an indication for red cell transfusion. If there is a moderate cardiopulmonary disease or surgery, hemoglobin level of 10 gram per deciliter is a trigger for transfusion. In the presence of symptomatic anemia, hemoglobin level of around 8 gram per deciliter, the patient is transfused. In a bleeding patient or a phlebotomy exceeding 25%, again it is an indication for red cell transfusion. Patient has to be transfused to maintain a minimum hematocrit. However, one should not try to replace the iatrogenic losses. Rather, one should try to minimize the iatrogenic losses. This is the RBC transfusion thresholds for the preterm neonates. This is less than 28 days neonate with assisted ventilation. If the fraction of inspired oxygen is greater than 0.3, then hemoglobin level of 12 gram percent is a trigger. If the fraction of inspired oxygen is less than 0.3, then a hemoglobin level of less than 11 gram percent is the indication for RBC transfusion. If the neonate is on continuous positive airway pressure, CPAP, then it depends what is the age of the neonate after being born. If it is the neonate is greater than 28 days, then a hemoglobin level of less than 10 gram percent is an indication. If the age is less than 28 days, then a hemoglobin level of 10 gram percent is the indication. If the patient is breathing spontaneously and the fraction of inspired oxygen is greater than 0.21, then a hemoglobin level of less than 8 gram per deciliter is the indication. Or if patient is breathing spontaneously well in air then the trigger can be as low as 7 gram per deciliter. The traditional red cell neonatal transfusion should be given in a small aliquot, because if we give a larger unit for the neonate, once opened, it has to be, after transfusion, the rest of the blood has to be discarded. So smaller proportions have to be prepared from one unit of blood so that the patient can be transfused closed cell, and they have to be relatively fresh, less than 5 to 7 days old, or washed CPD A1 red cells, usually requested because of the concern about increased potassium level and decreased 2-3 DPG level in the older blood, or toxicity related to storage media additives like saline, adenine, glucose, mannitol has adenine and mannitol, which can be sometimes harmful for the select group of neonates. Like to preserve red cells for a longer time, saline, adenine, glucose, mannitol is used, and adenine is utilized to generate ATP, but it metabolites crystallize within the kidneys to cause glomerulosclerosis. In adults also, it can cause nephrotoxicity if it is given in a dose of 95 mg per kilogram over a 5-day period. But sometimes in extracorporeal membrane oxygenation or cardiopulmonary bypass, the level of adenine that we add by giving blood stored in additive solution can be very high. So one has to remove the additive solution. The mannitol in the additive solution may promote diuresis and thereby decrease the intravascular volume and diminish the cerebral blood flow. That is why the concern is there. Though additive removal is not necessary for typical small volume transfusion, but for large volume transfusion, if the blood is preserved in the additive solution, the additives should be removed by centrifugation of the blood. Another concern which is there for the neonates is the large number of donor exposures because of the frequent transfusions. Suppose a neonate needs transfusion every other day or needs exchange transfusion, then that particular neonate will be exposed, or the blood will be used from a number of donors, and this increases the chances of disease transmission or exposure, and also increases the chances of aluminization. Therefore, the focus should be on limited donor exposure programs to decrease the number of exposures, so that we can decrease the risk of disease transmission and also reduce the risk of aluminization. Though it increases the workload of the blood bank, increases the complexity to the inventory management, and special equipment are required, which are called a sterile connecting device, like this shown in the slide, where you can collect the two tubings of a blood bag in a sterile manner, in a closed manner, and then amount of blood needed for the neonate from a bag is transferred to another bag for use. And that particular bag may be dedicated for a neonate, and small amounts may be taken out using this device as and when required for a number of transfusions. So neonate is not exposed to larger number of donors. This is another manner, like these are the pedipacks which are shown over here. They are also commercially available, and from one unit of blood, donated unit, small portions can be made in bags like this, which are called as pedipacks, and they can be issued one at a time for a particular unit. And this, all four or five bags can be assigned to one particular unit in times of, for times of need. These are the special transfusion equipment like syringe with a filter, which is also available for neonatal transfusion, where a measured amount of blood can be given through a blood filter to a neonate. And this can be sometimes very helpful for small volume platelet transfusion, where platelet have to be also be given through the filters. Another processing which is required for the neonates and small children is irradiation, that is blood irradiation. This is done using gamma irradiation. A dose of 25 gray is used for irradiation, and this is for the prevention of transfusion associated graft versus host disease. We had discussed earlier that how the immunological system of these neonates is immature, and they are able to eliminate the donor lymphocytes which are there in the blood, and these donor lymphocytes can then mount a graft versus host disease against the recipient or a neonate. When you irradiate a unit of blood, then the DNA in the donor lymphocyte is inactivated, is damaged, and which renders them incompetent to mount a reaction against a neonate cells. So all cellular components given have to be irradiated, and the indications for irradiation in this population is all the intrauterine transfusion, which is used a number of time for the management of the hemolytic disease of newborn, then premature neonates or neonatal extracorporeal membrane oxygenation, then in neonates with congenital cell mediated immunodeficiency, and also when there are directed donations from the biological relatives, which is very frequently there in the developing countries, where parents may volunteer to give blood, donate blood for the neonates, or sometimes they are the only compatible blood which is available for these neonates. This transfusion associated graft versus host disease is characterized by fever, erythematous maculopapular rash, diarrhea, elevated liver enzymes, adenopathy, pancytopenia. This is a hallmark feature of the transfusion associated graft versus host disease, because here the recipient marrow is also a foreign tissue. So the lymphocytes, donor lymphocytes, T lymphocytes, mount a reaction, immunological reaction against all the cells which carry the HLA antigens of the recipient. And the symptoms begin 2 to 30 days after transfusion. It is the fatality of this transfusion associated graft versus host disease is very high. Its fatality is there in 90% of the cases. Therefore, it is important to take steps for the prevention by irradiation. Another concern for the neonates is cytomegalovirus infection, though it is not a very much of concern in the adult population, and we need not do not screen for cytomegalovirus in this adult population. But premature infants less than 1200 gram are at increased risk of overwhelming cytomegalovirus infection. Therefore, the seronegative pregnant females, the fetus, and the premature infants, they require CMV safe cellular blood component. CMV safe blood components for full term or premature infant of CMV seropositive mother is not well established. If the mother is CMV seropositive, then it is not evidence based to give, or rather to look for CMV safe components. And this can be achieved by providing leukofiltration blood if the prevalence of CMV infection or the CMV antibody is very high in the population. So leukofiltration provides a protection against CMV. Then another issue which has to be seen in the neonates is directed donation. Many times for neonates or small children, directed donations where the donor particularly donates for a particular recipient is there, and if the blood donor is a blood relative, then the blood components have to be irradiated. And if the patient is undergoing stem cell transplantation, the family should be excluded as blood donors, because then it leads to particular HLA aluminization, and then subsequently it may be difficult to get a graft from the family members. And parents should also be excluded if immune-mediated hemolysis or thrombocytopenia are present. Particularly, the father should be excluded as a donor because he would be carrying the culprit antigen. Mother can be a potential donor, then one has to process the blood, the red cells or platelets to wash them to remove the implicated antibodies in the present in the blood. So if those facilities are not there, they have to be avoided as a potential donors. It's very important that we limit the iatrogenic blood loss in the neonates. This can be done if we use the testing technology which uses minimum blood sample like gel technology for testing. Then also minimize our blood sampling to minimize the blood draw. Then on-site testing by bedside testing devices like thromboelastography and other devices, point of care devices which decrease the blood drawing in the anticoagulant and they do require reduce the blood drawing requirement. Then pre-transfusion testing at blood if it is required, then umbilical cord blood can be used, utilization of maternal plasma can be there for compatibility testing, and American Association of Blood Bank and the other organizations have relaxed the cross-match requirements for transfusion for these patients up to the 4 months of age. So if the patient is not having any antibody or the neonate is not having any antibody, irregular antibody, then the blood for the cross match may not be sent again and again. So these are the criteria for pre-transfusion testing. For infants under 4 months of age, both mothers and neonate sample is required. ABO and RHD grouping on the mother sample has to be done, and also the irregular antibody screen. Irregular antibody means non-ABO antibody which is IgG kind, because this antibody can cross the placenta and could be there in the neonate blood at significant level up to 4 months of age or 6 months of age. So compatibility testing has to be done, and the neonate sample ABO cell grouping is done, RHD typing is done. Reverse typing is not done because there are no ABO antibodies developed at this age. Then one has to also do a direct antiglobulin test to see if there are any antibodies from the passive antibodies from the mothers which has crossed the placenta and they are causing hemolysis in the neonate. And the blood has to be compatible, ABO and RHD compatible with both mother and the neonate. Cross-matching has to be done with the mother sample if irregular antibody screen on the mother sample is positive. And if there are no antibodies, further cross-matches can be omitted. This is the choice of blood group for transfusion, PRBC transfusion. If the neonate blood group is O, whatever is the mother's blood group, you have to choose O group PRBCs. Also, if the mother's blood group is O, whatever is the neonate's blood group, you have to choose the red cell which is O. Over here also in the red columns, it has to be O group only. So if the mother or the neonate is O group, always it will be O group. And then you have to decide if the, suppose the mother's blood group is A and the neonate blood group is also A, then definitely A will be compatible with both mother and neonate, or group O. Group O will also can be a good alternate. So if you see in all these columns or the squares, the one can safely give group O cells if one is not able to do compatibility testing or one is not knowing much about immunohematology. Then group O red cells will be compatible with both neonate and the mother. And otherwise, if you want to give group specific blood, then you have to really know what is the mother's blood group to see that you provide compatible blood to this particular neonate. Like you can see here, the neonate blood group is suppose A. If you have not done the mother's blood group, then you could have provided a neonate A red cell. But here you can see that we cannot give, if the mother's blood group is B, the anti-A, mother's anti-A would have crossed the placenta and could be there, and therefore A group will be incompatible. So you have to give O red cells. So that is why it is important to keep in mind that both the neonate and the mother's blood group. So now coming to the volume and rate of transfusion, one can calculate the volume that has to be transfused depending on the desired hemoglobin that has to be achieved, the actual hemoglobin, the weight in kg multiplied by 3, and in the exchange transfusion, whether we want to do a one volume exchange or two volume exchange, accordingly we can calculate by the blood volume of the neonate. In a term kg, around 80 ml per kilogram, and in a preterm the blood volume is taken as 100 ml per kilogram. The rate of infusion should not be such or high to induce the circulatory overload, and it should not be greater than 10 ml per kilogram per hour in the absence of cardiac failure. But if the cardiac failure is there, it should not be greater than 2 ml per kilogram per hour. If more volume is to be transfused, it should be done with smaller aliquots. Now, a word about transfusion reactions in neonate. The febrile transfusion reactions are less likely to occur in neonates, and acute hemolytic transfusion reactions majority of times are due to passively acquired antibodies. So when we are giving, say, plasma transfusions or platelet transfusions, we have to see that there are no incompatible antibodies in the given plasma which can hemolyze the neonate red cells. However, delayed hemolytic transfusion reactions are uncommon because of the lack of immune reaction. The other reactions like transfusion-related acute lung injury, transfusion-associated cardiac overload, TACO, or anaphylaxis, or product-specific reaction like bacterial contamination can occur, and they require diligent patient monitoring. So in special circumstances, whole blood may be indicated, especially if fresh whole blood may be indicated. If there is a dilutional coagulopathy or coagulopathy due to consumption. Few words about the platelet transfusion, which is again an increasing component which is increasingly transfused for the neonates. Different criteria than adults are used. At counts above 1 lakh, even if the patient is bleeding neonate, then one has to look for the other causes. It could not be platelet transfusion is usually not indicated unless there is a functional problem with the platelets. In a count less than 30,000 per microliter, prophylactic transfusion should be given to all patients because the concern is to prevent the intracranial bleed. If the patient is bleeding, neonate is bleeding, definitely the transfusion has to be given. If the patient is auto-ITP, that is immune thrombocytopenic purpura, the patient has to be transfused if bleeding is present or IVIG is not available for the treatment. If it is neonatal alloimmune thrombocytopenia, then patient has to be transfused with HPA compatible platelets if the patient is bleeding. At counts between 30 to 49,000, patient need not be in a non-bleeding neonate, patient need not be transfused if clinically stable. Transfusions have to be considered if the weight of the neonate is less than 1000 gram, or the neonate is less than 1 week of age, or the neonate is clinically unstable. Previous major bleeding tendency is there, like grade 3 or 4 intraventricular hemorrhage. Current minor bleeding is there, like petechy, purpuri or oozing. There is a concurrent coagulopathy, requires surgery or exchange transfusion. In these, presence of any of these, a non-bleeding neonate has to be transfused at a count of 30,000 to 49,000. But if the neonate is bleeding, then even at this count need to be transfused. For auto ITP patient, if the patient is not bleeding, we need not transfuse. And for neonatal albumin thrombocytopenia, neonate has to be transfused with HLA compatible platelet only if bleeding is present. At a count of greater than 50,000 but less than 99,000, non-bleeding neonate need not be transfused. But if the neonate is bleeding, he has to be transfused. Auto ITP need not be transfused, but neonatal albumin thrombocytopenia patient have to be transfused if the patient is bleeding. They have to be either ABO identical or compatible to prevent the plasma antibodies induced hemolysis. Should be RHD compatible, identical or compatible, so that they don't lead to albuminization RHD specifically. It should be HPA, human platelet antigen compatible, if the cause of thrombocytopenia in a neonate is neonatal alloimmune thrombocytopenia, which is just like a hemolytic disease akin to the hemolytic disease of newborn, caused by maternal antibodies which have crossed placenta, which are against the antigen inherited from the father on the neonate platelets, most commonly against the HPA1 antigen. So 1A antigen. So neonate has to be provided in this condition the HPA matched platelets. The platelets have to be irradiated if indicated, and a volume of 10 to 20 ml per kilogram of body weight has to be given, and they have to be transfused through standard blood filter. Fresh frozen plasma given to neonates should be either group AB or compatible with the recipient red cell. Dose is around 10 to 15 ml or 20 ml per kilogram. The cryoprecipitate dose is around 5 ml per kilogram of body weight. Now few words about the intrauterine transfusion, which is given to the neonates mainly suffering from hemolytic disease of newborn to correct fetal anemia. Aim is to prevent or treat high drops and enable pregnancy to advance to safe gestational age, that is 36 to 37 weeks. It can be given either by in the patients or the neonates ultrasound guided intraperitoneally to the fetus or in the umbilical vein of the fetus. The details I would omit because it is for the gynecologist and obstetricians to know. And the target hematocrit is around 35 to 40%. It is done once begin. IUT is done periodically until delivery. Usually every 2 weeks the intrauterine transfusions are done. And the red cells which are selected for transfusion are group O RhD negative unit, and also negative for the antigen corresponding to which the mother is having the antibody or which is the cause of hemolytic disease of newborn. They have to be fresh, leukofiltered, irradiated, CMV negative with a hematocrit of 75 to 80%. So majority of plasma is removed to make it hyper concentrated to reduce the volume load, and they should also lack the hemoglobin S, or the sickle hemoglobin should be there. This is in nutshell about the neonatal and pediatric transfusion. Any question answers are welcome at this stage.